Now, we're also talking about the victims today. Imagine what they were thinking, some of whom were in that courtroom, trying to imagine whether or not they would testify, what they would say against the man that they say has sexually assaulted them. Well, on with us right now is Tom Klein. He's an attorney for one of the alleged victims. Christy Paul is also with me. And Tom, it's great to have you with us, and we appreciate your time.
Good to be here. Now, although it's a little colder than when Mr. Amendola was here a moment ago. That's why I need the coat.
Oh, okay. Well, tell me what you think about Joe Amendola and what he was saying this morning about the victims. In particular, he seemed to cast aspersions on whether they were telling the truth.
Well, I think it's a great accomplishment for any lawyer who's able to summon the International Press Corps to Bellefonte, Pennsylvania, and hold an hour-long press conference on the courthouse steps and get everybody's attention. So I think he succeeded in that. I don't think that he's been very successful in very much else today. What I've seen happen is that the prosecution was well prepared, was ready to go forward. I was sitting in the first row behind the prosecution table, if you will. I was literally there when they all went back into the back chambers, obviously, to conclude this deal that they had worked out. But the fact of the matter is, and I think what comes out of this most, is that you have all of the young victims who are now young men who have a united sense of purpose, many of whom got to see each other today. I'm sure many of whom, from what I know, actually know each other and now know that they're not alone and see the others firsthand and in person after many years. So I think a lot of good comes out of it today and not very much downside to the prosecution. I think the best that the defense would have been able to do might have been to chip away at a count here or a count there, and they knew that they weren't going to be able to get beyond all of this overwhelming crush of evidence.
Mr. Klein, you've been representing, obviously, one of these victims. How well prepared were they to be there today, and how did they feel once they realized they didn't have to get on that stand?
Well, I haven't talked to my client since this happened. We've texted back and forth. I know that the sense of it from having done this many years as a trial lawyer, there's at first a sense of letdown. But this is something that's not going to go away, and it's not something that you have to prepare for just today. And that's certainly, when I see him later today, something that I'll be telling him. And I represent a fine young man who is certainly well understanding of the process to the extent he needs to understand it. And I'm sure that he, like the rest, will be prepared for the next phase of this.
And when, without compromising, obviously, any of your conversations with that victim, how do you plan to prepare him for what lies ahead? What do these victims need most as they move forward?
Well, I think they need to know something that they actually learned here today, which is that they're not alone, that they are in a position with a number of other young men who, by and large, in fact, everyone who I know of and who I know, who are young men who want to be on with their lives, who want to lead productive, full, and good lives, and here they are. Having to relive these memories. It's something that, as I've explained to my client, is a right of citizenship. It's something that sometimes you just do things that you don't want to do or that might get thrust upon you, but sometimes you do things for the common good, and along the way, those things for the common good are also good for yourself. Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, none of us obviously can understand what those men are going through. Men, and as I understand it, at least one underage victim, alleged victim here. How do you prepare them for the scrutiny that lies ahead? We got an indication that certainly they are going to be taken to task and questioned possibly aggressively by Joe Amendola and his team. And are they being counseled? Are they getting therapy through this whole process?
Well, I'm not going to get into the particulars of counseling and therapy and the like. I can tell you that there is nothing that Mr. Amendola is going to do that's going to push away or scare away the victims. That was part of the strategy as I saw it unfold in the days and weeks leading up to this hearing, that there was a lot of bold and brave talk by the defense that they were going to meet these victims face to face in the courtroom, and that Mr. Sandusky was going to be there, and that some of the victims were going to back down, and that just hasn't materialized. The fact of the matter is that 52 counts remain against Mr. Sandusky. Those counts are standing, now pushing forward to trial, and there's no changing the basic dynamic here. There was a web of conduct which meets the similarity test, the credibility test, and all of the indicia that would be needed to prove the case at trial.
Tom, I know one of the concerns you had on speaking to us today was you didn't want to reveal the number of your client in this particular case. The victims have been numbered, the alleged victims have been numbered 1 to 10. And it got me thinking, do you have a concern about whether these young men will be exposed and in some ways, I don't want to use the word ostracized, but have a tough time in the community just by being associated with this case?
Well, I do have that concern, and I've done everything I can responsibly to assure that the story becomes known, but the name and the identity of my client does not. Today there was a real concern that we were going to be in a fishbowl, that while the witnesses were not going to have to raise their hand and say their name, that they were going to have anonymity. But we all knew that in the courtroom there was literally tweeting allowed, and that of course, while maybe not in the mainstream media where names won't be identified, that there's a blogosphere out there, and of course that they were going to be identified. My concern has frankly been that I need access to my client, that I want access to my client, and that he wants to protect his identity, and therefore I'm going to do whatever I can to accomplish that.
Tom, are you concerned as we look forward to the trial in this case? One of the big concerns when you have so many victims is that one person or another person offers a detail that may differ from something that was offered earlier, and the defense, rightfully so, is going to try to attack the credibility of a lot of these victims. Are you concerned that even if your client comes forward and offers his story, that the other parts of other people's stories, or for example, the questions that are now being asked about Mike McCreary and what he saw, could end up hindering your client's ability to get justice in this case?
Well, there are a number of components to your question. It strikes me that the case does not rise or fall on Mr. McQuarrie. That's for starters. That involves one particular incident at one particular time. And at least insofar as the criminal case goes, that really doesn't have much bearing on a lot of what these other victims have to say. Usually, when you have three or four people who witness one event and they tell different stories, then you, of course, can have a classic credibility issue, and you can have classic conflict of testimony. Here we don't have that. We have different witnesses telling different stories that serially link up into a long process, a longer story. But as for what my client might say being contradicted by someone else, I don't see that happening. I see my client as having a story to tell. It is a credible story. It's not a story which he could have invented or made up. And it is very similar in content, in context, in a lot of other aspects to the stories that are being told by these other victims. The place where these things took place, the manner and method by which the perpetration took place, the actually down to the kind of advances that are made, including the ways that that Sandusky went about doing things. I think that they will actually link together rather than unlink.
All right. You know, Tom, one more thing here. Joe Amendola said a little bit earlier in a press conference that Jerry Sandusky had given him information that they would be using at trial. We asked him about that, and he mentioned that a number of the victims, at least according to him and based on what Jerry Sandusky was telling him, were still maintaining contact with Jerry Sandusky.
Yes.
And I just want to ask you, so you can set the record straight, again, we're not aware of the number of your client, but has your client maintained any contact with Jerry Sandusky? And if so, what has that contact been, or how does he feel about that in general?
Well, I'm not going to get into those specifics,
okay.
But I will tell you, but I think that my answer help go to some measure with to answer the question that you've asked.
Mm-hmm.
Many of these victims, not surprisingly so, looked to Sandusky, who showered them with gifts and tickets and games and all of the things that he did, which formed the pattern of conduct which he had with all of these various young men who became his victim. Of course they looked to him. Of course they were disappointed when they wouldn't see him. Of course they wanted to maintain contact with him. That's how he got their trust to begin with. They were victims, and anyone who knows anything about sexual predators, who knows anything about sexual abuse, who knows anything about sexual victimization and other victimization, knows that's exactly how victims react. All that does, in my view, is contrary to Mr. Amendola's statements, it proves the case against Sandusky, not the case in Sandusky's defense.
All right, Tom Klein, it's great to have you on. And Tom, I want to extend to you the same thing that I extended to Joe Amendola. As this proceeding goes forward, as we go to trial, I want to invite you to come back and also to share your thoughts about what's going on, because we're interested in portraying both sides, and you certainly have a client that is just so significant to this case. And Tom, we appreciate you.
And I'm happy to be here and happy to have the opportunity to have the discussion. Thanks very much.
Sure thing, Tom.